Thanks everyone for joining. We'll just wait for a couple more minutes as more people join us. But in the meantime, if you could include your name, organization, and introduce yourself in the chat box. We'll start shortly. Thank you. Hello, everyone. Welcome. Thank you for joining us today. So I'm Peggy, the Early Childhood and Climate Change Advisor at the Asia Pacific Regional Network for Early Childhood, ARNEC. And I'm your moderator for this webinar. So happened that I also have a bad hair day today. On behalf of ARNEC, we are very happy to welcome you today to our webinar today, From Pollution to Solution, Clean Air for Young Children in Asia Pacific. So today is also the International Day of Clean Air for Blue Skies, and this webinar brings together diverse partners to highlight the urgency of taking collective action towards air pollution, which is a key climate and environmental degradation issue in our region here. I also wonder how many of us here are truly concerned with air pollution and climate emergencies. It's really hard to keep track nowadays, the number of headlines we now see on climate change, and also the number of apps we have in our phones to track air pollution, AQI, typhoons, and storms. So please, if you can, take a moment to introduce yourself in the chat box with your name, country, organization, and also put a yes if air pollution affects you or the people around you. If you could just take a moment here to introduce yourself and also, yeah, just indicate if you and the people around you are affected by air pollution. Yes, I see Anlan, thank you for your response there. Welcome, Natala. Hi, Bina. Hello, Anna Maria. Yes. Great. Hello, Sarah. Thank you. Yeah, and if you can keep your introductions coming and then also just mention, yeah, I see an overwhelming responses in terms of yes, that air pollution affects you and also the people around you. Delhi is toxic and it's very worrisome. Okay, so air pollution, climate and environmental impacts are already here and will only intensify we need to treat it as a mainstream issue with also implications on our ECD sector affecting young children, as this is not just a sideline emergency. Next slide, please. Jahao? So as you can see from the screen here, these are our objectives for our webinar today, to highlight that air pollution and also climate change is also an early child development issue. The Harvard Center on Developing Child latest guide underscores the importance of reducing sources of stress, including the physical environment, as it affects young children's brain and also their body development. So we are very excited to feature today this webinar, Initial Progress of an ECD and Climate Change Advocacy Toolkit that ARNEC and Vital Strategies are developing, as well as feature multiple perspectives, voices of youth and environmental experts on this intersection on ECD and climate change and air pollution, which is a key environmental degradation issue in our region. Next slide, please. Next slide. So this is a session. I'm hearing some background noise. If everyone can mute themselves. Okay, if you can go back one slide before, Jahao. Yes, so this is the session overview of our webinar today. We have an exciting panel of speakers for you today, including climate and environmental experts and youth advocates. We'll start off with opening and framing to introduce to you to our ECD and climate advocacy, and also share initial progress on the ECD and climate change advocacy toolkit. We'll then follow with a 40-minute dialogue with our special guest speakers, including a presentation on why air pollution is an early childhood issue, as well as dialogue between youth and experts on this, moderated by our expert from the World Resources Institute, India. We'll then follow by two expert remarks from UNICEF East Asia and Pacific Regional Office, as well as Plan International, to share recent climate change publications, to highlight that climate change and air pollution is indeed a crisis for young children as well, in Asia Pacific, and one that needs appropriate policy and financing support. We'll then conclude the webinar with closing remarks and brief evaluation. We intend to make this pretty interactive, and we'll have Q&A woven throughout the session. So please feel free to use the chat function to raise any questions or comments that you have. And the session is recorded, and we'll make sure to share the video recording with you after this webinar. Next slide, please. So the next presentation is by Evelyn Santiago, who's our executive director at ARNEC. She will share an overview of ARNEC's ECD and climate change advocacy, and also to introduce you to the ECD and climate change advocacy toolkit. So over to you, Evelyn.
Thank you. Thank you, Peggy. And good afternoon, everyone. Thank you once again for joining us today in this very important conversation about air pollution on the occasion of International Day of Clean Air for Blue Skies, as already mentioned by Peggy. So blue skies that we all dreamed of for our young children and the future generation. What I will be sharing with you today is a quick overview of our advocacy on the intersection of ECD and the environment, specifically the issue of climate change as this affects young children. And of course, addressing air pollution is a big part of this advocacy. Can you go to the next slide, Chow? Yeah. Our key message is actually very simple, that while young children are the most vulnerable when it comes to the impact of climate change and environmental degradation, they are also the most valuable asset that we have in fighting against it. And that early childhood development is an effective pathway to build climate resilience and boost sustainable development. In this slide, you know, you will see that the impact of climate change is not necessarily even. Young children are disproportionately affected by it. And according to the World Health Organization, nearly 90% of the global health burden on climate change affects young children under 5. But then it is not just one sector that is affected. it's across all the components of the nurturing care, as you can see in the slide. For example, on health, and this is exactly related, you know, to air pollution. The data that you see there says that 17 million babies under the age of one breathe toxic air, and majority of this live in South Asia. And when you look also at the safety and security of young children, the UNICEF's Children's Climate Risk Index identified 6 Asia Pacific countries as extremely high risk from climate change. And these countries are Pakistan, Afghanistan, Bangladesh, India, Myanmar, and the Philippines. And then if you look at the Pacific Islands, 90% of Pacific Islanders, excluding PNG, live by the coastline with constant threat of sea level rising. Next, please. Okay. Since 2019, ARNEC has been working with partners such as Save the Children, UNICEF, and Bernard Van Leer Foundation on the foundational work of this advocacy, looking at the intersection of ECD and climate change. We've held a number of webinars, learning events. We've developed call to actions, convened panel discussions, you know, as well. So among other things, the foundational work all aims towards raising awareness of policymakers and other stakeholders on the ECD and climate change intersection, highlighting, you know, the situation and needs of young children across the nurturing care component. Next, please. This slide shows some of the platforms that we use to amplify our advocacy on early childhood development and climate change. Early this year, we have launched a joint scoping study, which we call Most Vulnerable to Most Valuable, as you can see, you know, in the screen. And I hope you are able to read, you know, the details of that scoping study. But it articulates the impacts of climate change and environmental degradation on young children's development and informed the design of climate risk-adapted ECCD programs. We regularly join forces with different experts, parent groups, and youth advocates as well to amplify this linkage at regional events and webinars, including the recently held Southeast Asia Policy Dialogue on ECCE in Jakarta, hosted by the Ministry of Education and co-organized by the ASEAN Secretariat, ARNEC, Simeo Jechep, and Tanota Foundation. We've also held a learning forum in Cebu, Philippines last month, attended by 80 participants from 17 countries, all, you know, with a united voice on the need to address the issue of climate change as it impacts on young children. Through our webinars and micro research initiatives that we do with local, you know, partners, agencies, you know, institutions at the country level, we increase visibility of voices and perspectives from countries in the region. Next, please. So with an increased understanding on the intersection of ECD and climate change, we came up with a framework for action to guide our advocacy. This slide is our current conceptualization of that framework for action. We envision a global ECD and climate change initiative with 4 outcomes related to policies, ensuring that climate policies are ECD sensitive, at the same time ensuring that ECD policies and programs are also considering climate actions. The second outcome is in the area of finance, recognizing the need for ECD to have a share in international climate financing. Third is coordination, enhanced cross-sectoral coordination between ECD and climate sectors. Data and evidence, the need to elevate young children and families' needs via current and future research. And the last but most importantly is to build the capacity, you know, at the country for increased understanding and strengthened advocacy on the linkage of ECD and climate change. These four outcomes are supported by four action pillars related to advocacy, research and evidence, knowledge hub, and capacity building, again, at the level of the country, of the countries. So in a nutshell, this is what we have done, and we continue to do so in support of our advocacy for ECD and climate change. So with this, I'm turning the floor over to Lynn to walk us through the initial, you know, status of the ECD and climate change advocacy toolkit that we're working on, you know, with Vital Strategies. Lynn, over to you.
Thanks, Evelyn. Okay, so as Evelyn mentioned, we are working with ARNEC to develop an ECD climate communications toolkit. And the purpose of this toolkit is to make a coherent case to ECD climate key decision makers on the fact that they need to incorporate ECD considerations in climate plans. So the objectives here is to write a common language for champions to advocate for ECD climate mainstreaming in policies and financing, visualize concretely climate and environmental stresses affecting the nurturing care framework, so that champions can take collective actions within the ECD systems, and establish a base set of materials for customization across contexts for further amplification. So what's in this toolkit? Well, to be honest, we're still in the process of developing and workshopping this, but it would definitely include fact sheets, infographics, microsites, social media, widgets, and possibly in-person events and workshops as well. Next slide, please. So this is my title. I'm working for the Environmental Health and Climate Division at Vital Strategies. Next slide, please. So just a little bit about Vital Strategies, because not many people may have heard about us. We were founded about 20 years ago, and our headquarters is in New York. And we are an international NGO focusing on public health. We now have a presence in over 65 countries and about a dozen programs in various areas. So we share a common interest and vision with ARNEC in terms of addressing environmental pollution, climate change, and the health impacts on children. And just to share that a couple of years ago, we've also worked with UNICEF EPRO to develop a guidance document on children's environmental health indicators. And you can download this report from our website. Next slide, please. So what is the purpose of the toolkit? Now, we know that we have an immense challenge because there is a lack of awareness of climate and environmental impacts on very young children. In addition, when there is consideration of children in climate and environmental planning, there is a lack of desegregation of children according to age. And we all know that young children under 5 are very different from older children from a behavioral, cognitive, and physiological perspective. With this toolkit, we want to elevate the knowledge and awareness of health impacts. And I should say not just health impacts, but, you know, educational impacts, safety impacts, all the impacts under the nurturing care framework on young children. So we're hoping that this toolkit will encompass a wide range of offline and online communication strategies, including fact sheets, webinars, social media, in-person workshops, and more. And where possible, because it's most effective when we are targeted, we would like to create a specific communications activities or products for specific stakeholders such as ECD workers, journalists, youth, and policymakers. The end goal is that with this increased knowledge and understanding of this serious issue, there will be increased funding, resources, political will, technical capacity for actions and interventions that will reduce climate and environmental harms on young children and their families. Next slide, please. So one of the first products that we'll be coming up with is around air pollution. And we know that air pollution is a serious threat in our part of the world. If you take a look at this global map, you see that other than Africa, air pollution is an area where there are higher levels of PM2.5, which is the most health damaging air pollutant. And in fact, four out of the top five countries with the highest death rates due to air pollution are in Asia. They are China, India, Pakistan, and Indonesia. Next slide, please. So I only have one slide to talk about young children and their vulnerability, because I know that there's another speaker after me that will go into this in more detail. And I think a lot of people associate air pollution with the respiratory system, you know, because it's just an automatic connection with you know, bad air, difficulty breathing, difficulty, you know, having coughing, itchy eyes, and things like that. But not many people may know that air pollution also greatly affects the development of the brain. And the dosage required to cause damage to a child's developing brain is much lower than that of an adult brain. So there's research that has shown that prenatal and early childhood exposure to air pollution is linked to development delays in early childhood and symptoms of ADHD, lower IQ, anxiety, and depression, not just while they are children, but also later in life. The graph on the right is something that I've taken out of our fact sheet that is coming soon. And it just shows how young children are extra vulnerable to respiratory illnesses as well, because their lungs are still developing. Next slide, please. So let me say it this way. You know, air pollution also is a very critical issue because it has strong links to climate change. Here are a few reasons. One, the causes of climate change are often the same as the causes of air pollution. So we're talking about transport emissions, emissions from the power sector, industrial emissions, and crop burning, waste burning, agricultural burning. Some climate pollutants are also air pollutants, known as short-lived climate pollutants, or SLCPs. They are both harmful to human health and contribute to global warming. Examples of these SLCPs include black carbon and methane. We also know that climate change itself can worsen air quality with longer summers, wildfire, and drought, leading to increased levels of ozone and particulate matter. And I think this summer, this past summer, where we had, you know, terrible wildfires in Canada as well as in Hawaii, is a very salient point to illustrate this particular point. Next slide. Yes, thank you. And despite the strong links between air pollution and climate, and the ability to tackle these, you know, these birds with one stone, we unfortunately have found out that air pollution targets are missing from climate goals. So Vital Strategies reviewed the nationally determined contributions, NDCs, of 190 countries to evaluate the extent to which social vulnerability, health, and air quality have been considered. And we found that only 5% of countries specifically mentioned air pollution. This study and its report is laid out in a great detail on our website. You can have a look at it at www.vitalstrategies.org/risingtides. And what it really illustrates is that the policy and advocacy levers connecting air quality, health, and climate have been underutilized. So this is just a screen grab of the site that I was mentioning earlier. And it's just to show you that if you go into the site, you can actually look at not just region-specific, but country-specific scores in terms of how they've thought about health and other social determinants. So there really is an opportunity for us not to just include air pollution and climate goals, but in that process include the link between air pollution and early childhood. Next slide, please. So this fact sheet, like I mentioned, is one of the first deliverables and outputs that's coming soon. And in this fact sheet, we will highlight to you in more detail the following things. First, the health impacts on young children and pregnant women, the unique vulnerability of young children, the links between air pollution and established frameworks, such as the nurturing care framework and SDGs. And we also want to make it relevant for the Asia Pacific. So as far as possible, we'll include Asia Pacific specific statistics and concerns, as well as case studies and stories for inspiration. And of course, last but not least, we'll have a section on the call to action as to what you can do, you know, right away, really. So yes, the initial output will be this fact sheet, but we'll closely follow this with other digital informational products, such as social media, cards and microsite, and we really appeal to all of you to, when the fact sheet comes out, you know, to read it, to share it, and help us to spread it around. Thank you.
Thank you so much to both Lynn and also Evelyn for your sharing. Now we'd like to open up for a very brief Q&A for about 5 minutes perhaps. And yeah, I'm already seeing one question here. Has ARNEC also considered how air pollution can impact the 24-hour movement behaviors, including physical activity, sleep, and sedentary of children under 5? I think both of you can take this question. Yeah, so over to you.
Yeah, let me respond to that, Peggy. I think not really at the level of that detail, but what I would like to also add to what Lynn said is that this comms and advocacy toolkit, as we envision it, is something that should evolve, you know, as we get more information resources from, you know, our partners, you know, and stakeholders as well. And so if there is, we want to generate, of course, you know, more studies and evidence that would support, you know, this advocacy. So perhaps, you know, related to this, you know, evidence, or if there's a study that can be shared, then that's something that we can also consider, you know, as part of our effort to consolidate, you know, resources and have it in the microsite that we're also planning to have, so that it can be easily accessed by our partners, you know, and members.
Wonderful. Lynn, would you like to add anything?
Yeah, I think that's a good point to bring up, because, you know, children spend their time in various locations, whether they are, you know, beside the cooking stove, whether they're outdoors playing, whether they're in the preschool and all that. And every location has a different, usually has a different level of pollutant level. And, you know, it's good for maybe not ARNEC, but whoever, you know, has, you know, is in charge of a young child to really understand that the path that this child takes throughout the day, and whether there are certain measures that can be taken so that the path for this child is through a less polluted route. You know, maybe it can be like while the mother's cooking in the kitchen and pollution levels are high, you know, that might be a good time to get the child to play outdoors, assuming that the outdoors is clean. So I think it requires a really careful kind of plotting and thinking about the exposure levels throughout the activities of a child's day.
Thank you, Lynn. I also see one question coming in from An Lan from Vietnam. In the upcoming fact sheet, will you also have some educational learning impact to the child in addition to health impact? Lynn, would you like to take this?
We did not really factor the educational learning impact of air pollution. I think that's something worth considering, but as it is, the fact sheet is now quite full. I think the only educational aspect we did talk about is the brain development, you know, and the lower IQ and things like that, and that will definitely affect their ability to perform in school.
You know, Peggy, in addition to that, I think that the content of the toolkit itself is very much open. We're just starting with two fact sheets, one on air pollution and the other one on flooding, because these two impacts, you know, of climate change are really severely affecting our region. But overall, we're looking at the impact of climate change, you know, and air pollution specifically across the, you know, nurturing care components, and that includes, of course, you know, the early learning opportunities, education and learning impact. So I think there is, you know, a scope for that, and the idea is really to co-create this toolkit with you know, with partners and members. So again, you know, if there are some suggestions, we will gladly welcome, you know, those suggestions.
Thank you very much, Evelyn and Lynn, and also to all our participants for their questions. We'll also have other opportunity for Q&A. So yeah, maybe we can move on to the next segment if we don't have any other questions or comments. Next slide, please. Yeah, so our next speaker, it's Dr. Khun Thiti. She's an environmental health scientist at the Ministry of Public Health Thailand with over a decade of experience evaluating impact of environmental pollutants on the Thai population using a burden of disease indicator. And her current research focuses on developing strategies to protect population health from exposure to environmental hazards with a special emphasis on air pollution and climate change. So Dr. Khun Thiti, she'll take us through on why air pollution is also an early childhood issue. So over to you.
Hi. Next slide. Thank you. Next slide, please. Okay. Thank you for the introduction and give me opportunity to share my experience and my concern about the impact of air pollution on children health. So I will like give a short presentation and describe, you know, like based on when we are doing research and evaluate and priority setting the problem. So we normally came up with like 5 questions before investigate any health issue. So one is what we know about the issue and what we don't know yet, and how we quantify the issue in order to finally priority setting, like ranking the problem together using the burden of disease tools. And we also want to know like the longer consequences of the issue. And question number 4 and 5 go together, whether do we have enough evidence to solve the issue right now? And how can we solve it like equally without leaving anyone behind? Okay, next slide, please. So this is like the major framework. The problem of environmental impact on children is, let's say, it's very unique because as the figure here showed, we call it the life cost health development framework. We cannot just see what we how many children get sick right now, because there are possible health consequences of exposure at prenatal or at the young age, that it will cause the genetic change, or because in the field of epigenetic, that it will change or could impact your physical in the later in life. So let's say when, you know, when you measure the disease in older population, it might cause from like early exposure at their young age. So this is a very concern. We call we have something that called the terms called critical time window of exposure. So this is the time that once exposure to air pollution, it could change the genetic or physical of children. That is very important. And this is also the window of opportunity if we can do something to solve the issue and like protect them at like, you know, for the later developing disease in the future. And we also know this is kind of like we have very high evidence say that at the same situation, same level of air concentration, children will be definitely more impact than older adults in several points. First, because of their body, that they have like so they will consume more air per pound of body weight. So let me say that it's like a higher exposure to pollutants at the same scenario. And they also spend more time on the ground and outside. If they spend more time inside, they also could expose to indoor air pollution from cooking. And we also, what is my concern right now is like, we actually have little known about how some risk factor affect children. So we also have like a lot of like unknown about the issue. And especially what we concern right now is more mental stress, because once children cannot, if they don't know how to protect themselves, or they don't know what to do, they could experience more mental stress as a result of disaster or like high air pollution level at that point. So they might lose a sense of control. So that is like four major concern right now. Next slide, please. And so what else does we know about the air pollution impact on children? The best one is like, we know that air pollution shorten life expectancy. It depends on where you born. If you born in the area, let me say, so this is the result from study from the Chicago Institute, that they link the air quality concentration to the life expectancy, and they evaluate, because we definitely know that air pollution affect mortality rate. So once you combine these two together, you can know that if you born or live in the area with high level of air concentration, definitely it could impact your problem here, that we are, let's say, it could shorten your life expectancy. And once, but they also came with opportunity, if we can reduce the air concentration to the WHO guideline, definitely you can like get the gain, help them gain life expectancy. Yeah. Okay, next slide, please. And here's the another index that we use to measure the health impact in children. It's called years of life loss. Is measuring how you die prematurely from when, you know, when you expect to live. So we can see that here is the diseases that include in the global burden of disease study. We can see that most of them are disease of like older adult, like cancer, ischemic heart disease, and cardiovascular disease, COPD. There's so right now, even though we see that the lower respiratory infection is only one disease that specific to the sensitivity of children that included in the measurement right now, you can see that like more than half of what happened right now affect young children. The picture in the right show you that comparing to only children, we can see some part of the world, then we can see the spread of burden of disease that attributable to air pollution that is not equally, you know, affected. But we can say also that I would say that this figure could be actually underestimate the impact of air pollution on young children, because we know that it's not include the measurement of disease that's specific to children right now. Okay, next slide, please. So here is what we definitely know that is a concern. We have like high evidence to show the air pollution impact on health right now. So the first one is, you know, even before they born, they get affected by air pollution. So with the pre and postnatal exposure, it could cause low birth weight. Once along the lifetime exposure, you could be sure that there is effect. They have a can cause asthma and slower development of lung function, and also the development problems, as we heard before. And there are also more critical conditions that, since it's not disease, it's like symptoms like wheezing and coughs. So it's not included in the, you know, burden of disease measurement right now. And also they, like what we learned about the critical window of exposure, it could be the start of early sign of non-CD, like chronic disease later. And some more evidence right now is even like with the mental issue, that once they expose to air pollution at a young age, it also could cause, like make them more vulnerable to mental health disorder in the, you know, in the future. Okay, next slide, please. And so here are when I will describe, like when we say about, can we measure it? Because as I told you earlier, that at the end, we need to, the policymaker, sometimes when they weigh the evidence to know how to invest in, you know, in any health problem, we need to do the priority setting. So the concern, one concern is like right now that sometimes the evidence for the children, the scientific evidence for the children is still in the not enough evidence, let me say that. So to be sure, to so that we have the number to calculate the burden of disease. Based on the left figure, you can see that the it depends. Right now, for example, if like 100% of children getting asthma, we want to know that, okay, how many fraction of them is caused by ambient air pollution or household air pollution, and some cannot be avoidable, like a genetic disease or something. Is this is the fraction that is like we don't know right now. That's like because we cannot measure it, because right now what the evidence that we get it from epidemiology study, is from observation study, or from toxicology study, is from animal models. That's a lot of concern that, like, you know, we cannot conclude right now and cannot include in the model. Next, please. So here is I show you the diagram of how to develop the burden of disease based on air pollution. Right now, if we talk about burden of disease in young children or even the neonatal stage, we can see that, okay, air pollution data, we still cannot like get like the specific or very precise measurement for children. There's not much study about that right now. And therefore, we also cannot get the accurate population exposure, because like we cannot like right now we kind of like have the average, then we use the air pollution concentration as a proxy for exposure, which, you know, is still like have high uncertainty. And we also get the concentration response function that is mostly came from a study in adult, not specific to children. So overall of this cause the I would say right now the burden of disease attributable to air pollution in children is still underestimate like the real impact that happened in children. The next slide, please. Okay, for conclusion, I would say that yeah, definitely air pollution is definitely an early childhood issue. And what we have a lot of evidence already to know that what intervention is good and what can be effective in young children. So what we should do right now is scale what works. We know that there are critical development windows for children. We should like invest more and put the, you know, invest more evidence and let's say apply that intervention in young children. And we also, what we really need right now in terms of my perspective as a scientist is to enhance the accuracy of measurements and invest more study that is specific in young children and to get more understand the health impact of air pollution on children's health. And we also definitely because children, they impact a lot by air pollution, but they cannot do much to protect themselves because of like their physiology and their other issue. So that's why it's up to the adults and responsible agency to help invest in you know, how to help them defend themselves with a lot of like a solution that is available right now. Okay, that is what I have to say right now.
Mm-hmm. Thank you very much, Dr. Mm-hmm. Titi, for your very informative mm-hmm. Presentation. Uh-huh. We'll like to unpack it a little more. So yeah, for the next slide, please. Uh-huh. Uh-huh. Yeah, so let me just hand it over to our next moderator. He is Sree Kumaraswamy. He's from the World Resources Institute India. World Resources Institute India. A program director at the Ross Center for Sustainable Cities. And he provides technical and management guidance to teams working on areas of clean air strategy and children-friendly public spaces across different cities across in India. He co-designed the Nurturing Neighborhoods Challenge hosted by the Ministry of Housing and Urban Affairs with support of the Bernard Van Leer Foundation with WRI India as a technical partner to promote young children-friendly cities. And he is going to be our moderator for this next segment, which is an exciting segment on youth and expert dialogue as we unpack a little bit on this intersection between air pollution, with young children and ECD. So over to you, Sree Kumar. Thank you.
Thanks, Peggy. It's been quite an exciting discussion today. I think the discussion of the previous speakers around the need and the gap in the knowledge system, you know, how to meet in the knowledge system and how we want to really create products which can really help to bridge the sort of understanding around this unique sectors of air quality and application in the young children improvement in terms of especially around the health, right? So if we are looking at what can be done when the children don't know how to protect themselves, right? This is what Thitiporn clearly said, that you know, there are various issues of health and psychological development is linked to air quality, and how do we really help children and their caregivers to be able to be prepared to be help themselves to be protect themselves, right? So today we have a excellent group of youth experts here, and they are going to talk about their experiences in really putting these pollutions to solution on ground. And we have Riza, Annisa, Anggraeni. She works with the UNEP Children and Youth Delegate, and she's been doing a lot of interesting work in Indonesia, especially around climate and clean air. She's going to talk to us on her experience of especially working on communication and how to deal with the crisis in current situation. Then we have Spriha. She's also Spriha Shrestha. She's a senior coordinator with campaigns and external engagement with Save the Children in Nepal. She's been doing a whole lot of work on air quality improvement advocacy in Nepal. There's under this program of Shift for Our Planet. It's quite interesting to see this kind of advocacy, which is moving, including the you know, these discussions and voices of children in the governments. And then we also have Dafa. Dafa Mitra works with UNICEF Indonesia. Mitra Muda in UNICEF Indonesia has been working on various platforms, including COP27, and to take this issue of young children and the issue of air quality. So I welcome the panelists, and let me go to first to Riza. Riza, you've been doing this very interesting work on looking at the whole spike in air pollution in Indonesia and dealing with you know, how to really people know about the problem and how to how this, it's also an issue of communication crisis, right? Informing people at time and how to ensure that they are able to protect themselves and that to do it in the time of urgency. And the government can do a lot of things to ensure this happened to the last person in our communities. Can you please talk about your experiences?
Yeah, thank you so much. Before I start, I want to say thank you so much for having me here. And as a youth, I think we have the role to raise awareness, and communication is also the most important thing to talk about science, to talk about air pollution on this kind of era. So I want to start the conversation on one of the most pressing environmental issue of our time, and also a major health issue, the air pollution. So when we talk about air pollution, it's something that we talk about an abstract view because we cannot see it with our own senses. We may be able to see it, but when it has entered into the worst category, yeah? So communicating to the public about this issue is a complex task. It requires careful consideration of the goals and objectives of the communications, also the target audience, the type of information, and the messages to be conveyed, and also the vehicles or tools through which the message will be delivered. So it's one of the most important. So I'm gonna bring a concrete example. So in 2019, Indonesia's Ministry of Environment and Forestry has failed to communicate the risk of air pollution in the capital, Jakarta. So the data presented on the ministry's website shows Jakarta has a good air quality, making it unnecessary to warn the public about health risks from filthy air. But the data from Swiss-based app AQ Air Visual tell a different story, which is Jakarta some of the world's filthiest air, and this poses health risks to the public. So as a young person, in order to advocating this issue, we also experiencing the communication crisis when we facing climate crisis or environmental crisis. And in terms of air pollution, it's not so easy to apply the same advocacy or philosophy towards different cities in the world, because every city has different smells of air pollution. For example, in London, air pollution has the smell of diesel, and for Beijing has the smell of industrial fumes or coal, wood-based heating or transportation emissions, while New Delhi whiffs of burnt plastic and grass, as citizens still burn a lot of their rubbish. So understanding and communicating the risk of air pollution is highly important, because to warn the public about how it can impact them, especially a pregnant mother and the children before primary schooling. So I think the public has the right to know about the current environmental situation and receive clear information, not confusing or misleading information. So the UNEP has suggested to use art to communicate air pollution. For example, there is a Michael Pinsky. He is a visual artist, a British visual artist. He got inspired by the differences between the various types of air pollution when he set out to make a pollution pot. So the pots have very different sensation from one drum to another. And it means that it's not just to tell about how strong the pollution is, but they also have very different characteristics as well. And then there is Dan Rusegard. He's an engineer and an artist. He created a cleaner park, like an oasis. He created a smoke-free tower, which is the largest smoke-free vacuum cleaner in the world. So as Rusegard calls it, shocks up polluted air, cleans it, and releases it back into the atmosphere. So one of the most important is we are using the storytelling by using art, because when we talk about children, we can use their imagination and also their visual perception about things that they don't really have to understand about scientific things. Also, we can use a positive and negative messaging to talk with the public about the quality of air pollution. For example, some cities use a negative messaging and warnings when air pollution is bad. Amsterdam used like this: smoke or air pollution harms health. Stockholm, air pollution shortens your life. And Katowice, the air is bad, please watch out. And others appeal to positive feelings in the health messaging they use. For example, Warsaw, clean air, our common good. And then there is a Jednia, use the respect the air, it gives life. And also Sivirs in Poland underlines the importance of clean air for health with, if you love your children, don't burn rubbish. So some other readers like UNEP also use a positive messages such as, let's work together for clean air. Even a small decision can have a big consequences for health. And or stress the fact that people will live better with a cleaner air. So I think it's so important when we talk to public, to the public, but using the very sensitive thing, the smallest thing that we don't really know that really impactful for other mental health issue by facing this the kind of crisis. So I think that's all I can say now. Thank you so much.
Great, great. Thanks for that interesting storytelling you brought in, and the sort of positive messaging, the feel, and how we can be targeted not only to raise awareness but also make people to take steps in reducing pollution. Great. Now, can I invite Spriha? Spriha, if you can talk a little bit on our experience of advocacy for clean air in Nepal, and also how you are sort of bringing together this ground up communication, especially the voices of children and so on, towards this policy building and thinking of the government and so on.
Hello everyone. Thank you so much for having me here as speaker on Truth to Be Project this webinar. And I think we've had some amazing conversation in the last few sessions, and I hope that this webinar will provide us a platform to have more meaningful discussions so that we can all collectively address this important issue of air pollution and climate crisis that we are talking about today. Keeping the time constraint in mind, I'm just going to quickly start off with a general overview of how air pollution and climate crisis is affecting Nepal, young children in Nepal, and people's life in general, including young children and youth. So for most of you might already know, for those who do not, Nepal consistently ranks as the most polluted countries in the world. We've been frequently ranked as the top 10 most polluted countries in the world, and particularly Kathmandu, the capital city, has also made it to the top 3 most polluted cities in the world. And air pollution has had major impact on different sectors for young people and children and community members in general, being from health, education, childhood development, and overall quality of life. So just to throw in a little bit of data here, because we've already talked a lot about facts and figures and how air pollution is affecting people's life in general. So just to take out a few facts, the State of Global Air report mentioned that 42,000 people lose their lives to illness caused by air pollution in Nepal every year. That's a big number, right? Illnesses such as heart diseases, lung cancer, respiratory problems, all have been associated with air pollution. However, while there have been research and studies to how air pollution and these diseases are linked, I don't think there isn't like much resources still available on how early childhood development and air pollution are connected. And that's something that we still need to discuss and talk. And I think that's why we're also here today. Another shocking fact, a report from Energy Policy Institute at University of Chicago tells us that air pollution is the major health threat in Nepal, taking away almost 4.1 years from people's life. For cities where the pollution level is even higher, that's even worse, with the number going up to 7 years from a person's life, which is a sad, sad reality for all of us. And for people in Nepal, we are actually living that reality. When it comes to children, air pollution has had like major impacts on health, education. Just another fact, 22% of neonatal mortality in Nepal is linked to air pollution, and this is mostly related to indoor pollution from kitchen fire. And because harmful practices and gender inequality exists like quite evidently in Nepal, these kind of pollution tend to affect pregnant women and children more, because women being the person who takes charge of most household chores in Nepal, they're often exposed to such kind of pollution in the kitchen. And this has also had like major impacts on the babies and on infants when they're born. So these are things that we really need to look seriously into. And not just health. If you look at it, just to talk about a very recent example, only a couple of months ago, Kathmandu was ranked as the 3rd most polluted cities in the world. And when this happened, schools had to shut down. And this is a reality for days. Children couldn't go out. We were advised not to go out. We had to keep masks on all the time. Children were falling sick. People were falling sick. Even I did fall sick around this time. And this is something that has become more evident and something that we cannot ignore anymore. And while, because this conversation has also come up earlier in our previous sessions, when we're talking about environmental issues, I think it's not possible to look at them in isolation. We need to have a more integrated approach to how we look at such things and how we address those issues, right? So when you're talking about air pollution, sadly, not just air pollution, we in Nepal, we are experiencing a wide range of impacts of climate change in general. Only 2 days ago, I was in the field in the eastern side of Nepal, and I was communicating with some of our youth campaigners and our child campaigners and the community members. And they were sharing these personal stories about how we've experienced intense heat waves in the past year and how this has affected children. Children couldn't go to school because schools were shut down for weeks because of the heat waves. Even in schools, there were incidents of children passing out, you know, skin problems, irritation rashes, and they couldn't go out to play. And earlier in one of the sessions, we were talking about how climate change, air pollution is impacting children's mental development and, you know, their cognitive ability as well, because a lot of children now have to, because of such frequent occurrences, they have to stay in. They cannot go out, they cannot go play, they cannot have social interactions. And all of these issues are very multi-linked, and we need to have a more multi-pronged approach to addressing such issues. Another example from the eastern side again of Nepal, floods. We've experienced some very intense floods in the last few months. And because of floods, houses have been swamped, right? Children, they cannot go to school. Health, it has been majorly affected, and also food insecurity. Because sometimes, because of erratic rainfall patterns, sometimes we have too much rain and sometimes there's none at all. And that this is something we have experienced and seen in firsthand. So when there's too much rain, there's flooding, pumping other people's house and harvest. When there's drought, there's water shortages. And again, the implication is on women and children, because women, they have to walk like hours and kilometers just to like collect one bucket of water. So this is the harsh reality we're all living in. But unfortunately, young children and infants have emitted least amount of emissions, but they happen to bear the unequal burden of climate crisis and air pollution. And recognizing this fact at Save the Children, we're trying to see how we can, you know, as much as we can, incorporate children's voices and young people's voices, because they have a strong agency and they have a very important role to play in advocating for such issues, and they cannot go neglected. So last year, touching upon a little bit on what we've been doing to campaign and advocate for children and for climate crisis, and how we put children and young people at the center of these campaigning efforts. So in the last year, we carried out a big project called the Child Hearing Project, where we listened to 54,000 children on what they think is climate crisis, how they see climate crisis affecting the world. And these included 8,000 children from Nepal. And surprisingly, a whopping 85% of these children told us that they feel the immediate impacts of climate change in their lives, and that their lives have been affected by climate crisis and air pollution. But on the positive note, more than 50% of those children told us that they're really interested to do something about it, that they want to act on it, that they want to campaign against these issues. So realizing all of these things, we are right now taking a very multi-pronged approach on how we can include children and young people. And now to talk about a little bit of what we're doing to campaign. So Save the Children is running three major campaigns right now. One is called Shift for Our Planet, where we provide grants to young youth groups who then design their own campaigns. So what we do at Save the Children is we sit with children and young people and make them take lead on designing the campaign. So it's not adults enforcing their ideas on children. So they decide what they want to campaign on. They decide what kind of issues they want to impact on. And as Riza was talking about earlier, they tend to come up with very creative ideas, very interesting ideas, and something that is not very technical, something that everyone can understand and people of their age can understand. So that's how we've been doing campaigns. For Shift, we had some remarkable 5 youth groups who we provided grants, and they designed campaigns. We also paired them up.
Wind up time.
And for Generation Hope, another campaign that we're doing right now is Generation Hope, where we're taking like a big teddy bear, a 12 feet teddy bear across Nepal as a representation of how air pollution is affecting people and children's life in general. And all of while doing those campaigns, we're also collecting children's voices so that these voices can be fed into the national and international policy levels, right? And fortunately, one of our child champions will be participating in the SDG summit, upcoming SDG summit in September. She'll be talking about
what we've learned through these campaigns and representing their voices. And a lot of other campaign funds are also planning. This is how we're doing advocacy and campaigning. Sorry about the time. I think I'll wrap it up here, saying that we really need to enhance our children and young people's voice and agency for campaigning advocacy. Thank you.
Thanks a lot on that young people voice and agency, how to build it into the policy thinking in at higher levels of government and also higher levels of discussion across the globe. Great. Now, can we have Dafa? Welcome, Dafa, to talk a little bit about your approach of pollution to solution. Right, we are wanting to talk about what is that the measures we can take and how do we really induce these kind of behavioral changes which will sort of build up towards everyone will contribute towards reducing pollution and hopefully that will also help to reduce the health effects impact on the health and how you are able to tie this advocacy in the government. Over to you.
Okay, thank you so much, Mr. Sree Kumar, who've been given the opportunity to me and pass the time over to me. And it's such a great opportunity for me to share what have been done in Jakarta, especially because I'm focusing on the air pollution issues in Jakarta, which is currently happening. But beforehand, I would like to introduce myself first. My name is Dafa Pradia, and I'm from Mitra Muda UNICEF, Indonesia. And talking about the air pollution issues, first thing first, you have to look at the problem that occurred is a vast major issues around the big cities worldwide. So it's not only in Jakarta, but also in other big cities, like maybe in New Delhi, in London, in New York, even in Singapore. So we would like to look way further at the air pollution issues, which we are currently discussing. And also for disclaimer, I'll try to look at this problem from the city where I live, which is in Jakarta, Indonesia. So I would like to provide you some statistics or data. So according to the Jakarta Statistics Center Institute in Jakarta Transportation Statistics Report 2021, there were 21 million vehicles, cars and motorcycles counted only. So it's only counted as cars and motorcycles. Meanwhile, the number of citizens living in Jakarta is about 10.7 million. This is also from the JSCS in 2022. So if you see the data, there were a double numbers of between the citizens living in Jakarta compared to the vehicles that already or that occurred or that have been road every day in Jakarta. So also, if we see the public transportation coverage, currently, the government's officials say that 85% of Jakarta areas are already covered. And this is stated by the former governor of Jakarta, which is Anies Baswedan, in September 2022. So actually, we can travel anywhere using public transport. And also, as a person, I'm personally a person who often commutes with TransJakarta, which is the bus. I would say that it just takes around 35 until 40 minutes for 18 kilometers ride, or 25 until 30 minutes if there are no traffic jams. So it would less time consume if there are no traffic jams if I use the busway or TransJakarta. So it implies that we could save time more on the road and spend more time with the family at home, especially with the child, which could improve the quality of life of the child itself, because they got the right to have more time spent with their parents at home. And eventually, it's not just on the matter of infrastructure anymore, because we know that the infrastructure, especially in Jakarta, are already good. So as a youth, what we can do on this matter of issues? So basically, we could influence people through social media, as we know that most of young people are using social media the most compared to other generation. And we could provide or we could use this power to influence people to use public transportation more and do an event campaign every weekend about the benefits of using public transport based on the scientific research that exists with the collaboration with multi-stakeholders. It could be with the government, NGOs, community, or even the youth community, or just like random people Because in Jakarta, for example, we have a car-free day every Sunday throughout the year. So we could utilize that moment to influence people to do a campaign about using public transportation, or asking them to use public transportation instead of using private vehicles as their commutes, things in everyday life or on a daily basis. And also, it could increase the social behavior change effort more effective and reach a wide range of targets, because we do that on a campaign that been occurred or that will occur in the car-free day, where everyone just gather around the world in front in the center of the Jakarta's world. And also, as I've previously stated, the facility provided by the government is good already, but it would be even way better if the people also supported the sustainable future transition by relying on public transportation on a daily basis. So the government could maximize their work and improve the improvisation of public transportation service, and people would have less spending on the daily transportation cost, because it also impact for the economic cost. So people would spend less money to the transportation cost in month. And also back in COP27, it was also implied that one of the goals of COP to the government is to reduce air pollution and build a resilient city. And there are 5 takeaways that I've taken from the discussion that I've attended back in COP27, from the COP27 regarding the air pollution, or reducing the air pollution and improve the quality of life. The first point of takeaways from COP27 is build more green space in cities. The second one is fostering the just transition. The third one is encourage people to move to public transport for daily commute. The fourth one is installing filters for the gas exhaust pipe for the industries, because most of the industrial areas is focusing or are being centered or situated in big cities in the world, like anywhere in the world. Even in Jakarta, there are so many industries area. And the last one, or the fifth one, is to using direct carbon capture and storage, DACCS, and bioenergy with capture carbon and storage, BECCS, to reduce air pollution in big cities and industry center areas. Therefore, I believe this issue will be overcome only if the government and the people cooperate together in harmony to achieve the SDGs goal. Furthermore, the issue of air pollution is no longer about how we complain about the situation, but how we can project our power to solve it in an effective, clear, and sustainable way. And one of the solutions is to change the social behavior. So if we didn't start it now, how long we will gonna have to wait to change our social behavior and to support the government initiative to make a sustainable future transition? Thank you.
Excellent there, especially how the youth can contribute towards influencing social behavior and a larger sustainable goal, towards a sustainable goal, and also taking this to global discussions. Thanks a lot. We are quite a behind time schedule, and so now I will quickly get on to the next discussion with the experts, and we will continue to look at the questions as we go forward. Now we will have the expert discussions, expert remarks. First, we have Nicholas Rees, who is a program manager of climate and environment at UNICEF APRO. Welcome, Nicholas. Over to you.
Hi, can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you. loud and clear, yeah. Thank you.
Okay. Should I go ahead?
Yes, please. Yes.
Okay. Hi, everyone. A real pleasure to be here, and also to hear all of these. You know, I think the science on this and the all of the academic literature and the growth of the academic literature is so inspiring. And then equally inspiring are the perspectives such as Dafa in the last presentation, who just, I think, really nailed it with the call to action there. This is an area, it's funny, I think air pollution and children's health is not a new area at all. I think it goes back centuries. It goes back to, you know, essentially industrial times, when people started to, even then, they recognized that air pollution was such a critical issue for children's health. But it's only really now growing, and people are now fully able to understand the full impacts of this. The science on this is improving so much in recent years. Unfortunately, the policies haven't kept a pace with that. And so we aren't seeing as much improvement in with regards to the policies on air pollution as we would like to, but there are definitely some good signs of progress in certain parts of the world that I think have made a tremendous amount of progress in recent years. But the other thing I'd also like to point to is this, that there is this, you know, and it was brought up in the discussions here, this incredibly important link between air pollution and climate change. And it's not as simple of a link as what many people understand it to be, but it's an important link. And there's twofold. Obviously, from one side, air pollution, the causes of air pollution are very often the causes of climate change, the fossil fuel combustion and so forth. Similarly, climate change also does have an impact on how air pollution affects people and children as well, especially when you're combining it with extreme temperatures and so forth. So there are these links scientifically between air pollution and climate change. But another important thing I'd like to highlight too is that air pollution was in many ways what helped people fighting air pollution and addressing air pollution has its origins in the beginning of climate action as well. Climate action has often started with people being concerned about the environment around them and the environment that their kids are around, and challenging governments and industry to create a better environment for their children. And so there's also, you know, a social mobilization link between these topics as well. I think that is important. I'm going to do a little bit of a focus here on the impact of taking a step away from air pollution specifically and looking at a little bit about climate change across the region in East Asia Pacific. Over the last 50 years, we've seen a six-fold increase in climate-related shocks, hazards, and disasters in this region, which is incredibly shocking. And I think, you know, children of today essentially face six times the frequency of climate-related shocks compared to their grandparents. And I think that says a lot. There are twice as many storms, twice as many droughts, four times as many storms, five times as many landslides, and 11 times as many floods as what were recorded 50 years ago. So climate change is already here and already affecting children in East Asia and Pacific region. This isn't just something about the future and longer term impacts. We're here now, we're experiencing climate change. And we're only, in terms of the levels of warming, we're at roughly 1.1 degree of warming globally. And just in that level of change, we've seen a six-fold increase. As you get up to 1.5 and 2 degrees, that potentially increases even further, potentially even exponentially, depending on the specific shock or hazard. Next slide, please. And moreover, the number of kids in the region who are facing, and this is a critical point, it's not just one type of shock or hazards, it's potentially many types of shocks, stresses, and hazards. But the kids experiencing these almost at the same time in many circumstances. Over 140 million children highly exposed to water scarcity, 120 million highly exposed to coastal flooding, 210 million children highly exposed to cyclones, and a whopping 420 million children highly exposed to air pollution. But many of the kids exposed to air pollution are also exposed to cyclones and also flooding and also water scarcity and also other risk factors such as lead pollution and so forth, or pesticides. And what I want to highlight here is that kids in East Asia and Pacific, compared to any other place in the world, are experiencing a higher number of different types of shocks, stresses, and hazards. Roughly double the global average are experiencing four or more of these types of shocks, stresses, and hazards. Again, as I said, potentially at the same time. And all of this is exacerbating inequality because it erodes the coping strategies of the poorest children. It forces families to take kids out of school. All of this exacerbating inequality because it limits their potential for the future. Next slide, please. As I was just saying, this is, you know, that you have air pollution being one thing, and its interlinkages with all of these other climate and non-climate related shocks, stresses, and hazards are creating a whole range of cascading impacts: the environmental degradation, the loss of ecosystems, clean water, degraded living conditions, etc., make air pollution worse. And similarly, air pollution can also, there's a feedback loop there where you have multiple shocks and crises having cascading impacts, creating more multiple crises, all of this driving inequality, all of this creating a wedge between the wealthier children and the poorer children. And this is effectively a risk multiplier. Next slide, please. You can't read this slide, I'm sure. I'm sorry about the extremely small text. Basically, this is, you know, as we start to think about solutions now, one thing I want to highlight is, you know, this is an infographic from a recent report called Over the Tipping Point, which I encourage you to, you can look up, if you type in Over the Tipping Point, UNICEF into Google, this will come up. We're taking the perspective of what is a climate resilient child? And through a lot of consultation, we produced this infographic. And there are six key dimensions to this, to understanding what is climate resilience. The first is that every child, in order to be truly climate resilient, they have to have access to key social services, meaning in WASH, education, and health. And critically, not just, you know, this is before, during, and after shocks. Having access to these key social services is what builds resilience. So having that in the first place. The second piece is having access to social protection and child protection systems, again, before, during, and after shocks. The third dimension is access to relevant information and knowledge before, during, and after shocks. This includes like early warning systems, access to ICT infrastructure, access to knowledge and evidence on solutions to either better protect them and their families, and as well as come up with solutions to create a more sustainable environment in the first place. The fourth dimension is around resiliency planning and preparedness. This includes having children and young people engaged in the decision-making processes, both at local, provincial, as well as national, and even international levels. Resiliency of livelihoods. So this includes diversification of livelihoods, not being reliant on just one area for form of income, but potentially multiple. Same with assets, and having a wider variety of assets to rely on. And the fifth is around resiliencies of policies and governance. And again, this has to do with transparency, responsiveness of to community needs, public financial management systems that are transparent and linked to the social sectors. So I just encourage you to look at this because as we think about solutions in the ECD space, it's helpful to understand the full range of things that are needed for resiliency, and then you build in the solutions from there. Next slide. And maybe just to highlight in a little bit more detail, so we did a little bit of this thinking in UNICEF and in the regional office here. We thinking about, okay, what does it take to build climate resilient children and to help them become climate resilient. These are three areas that we thought were incredibly promising The first is around creating healthy environments for brain development for young children. As we all know, the first 1,000 days is a critical period of children's brain and body development and has implications for academic achievements throughout their lives. This kind of area would include tackling air pollution, lead exposure, other forms of pollution in early childhood spaces, childcare and kindergartens through innovative sustainable energy practices, for example, the use of filters, retrofitting buildings, systematic air quality monitoring, complemented with the social infrastructure side. So like awareness building, community initiatives to improve healthy development and learning of young children, especially the most marginalized populations. The second area is to invest in child-friendly green spaces. This helps build the foundation for brain motor development and 21st century skills. Play, as you all know, play is how children learn best, and accessible and welcoming green spaces through both structured, facilitated, or an unstructured free play can be very inviting places for children to play, learn, and be curious. And also develop those skills and that connection with nature that then becomes important for their whole lives. The third area is supporting families in green parenting to protect and prepare young children from the early years towards a resilient future. Parenting plays a critical role in shaping the future for their children. And so the unique vulnerabilities and exposure of young children and the places that they live places a great demand on parents and caregivers as first responders to support and empower their children. So really about, you know, investing in the parents and helping them to provide the environment, but also teach their kids about the world around them, about nature, and about ways to engage with nature so that they can become strong stewards of a sustainable future. So these are some of the areas that UNICEF is really kind of, that we are looking at the regional level, we're looking very closely at. But we'd love to your ideas in the discussion here to hear more about this, ultimately, because I think we're going to need a whole range of solutions across all of the sectors, but ECD cuts across all of the sectors, health, education, WASH, nutrition, protection, et cetera. And we need to make sure that these kind of actions are mainstreamed across a kind of a holistic climate response with regards to the social sectors and which children depend on so critically. I'll stop there. Sorry, I'm a bit over.
Thanks, Nicholas. That's quite useful framework of resilience for a child, looking at all those comprehensive factors and also your highlight of the poly crisis and the cascading crisis and how this is all leading to inequality and thinking through it and how we can think of solutions. Now, thanks a lot for that. And now we'll get on to the next speaker, next expert speaker. We have Jessica. Okay.
Great. Thank you so much. Hi, everyone. Yeah, really nice to see you.
Jessica is works with the Plan International. She has a great experience around this climate and the linkage with children. Please, over to you, Jessica.
Great, thank you. I know we're short on time, so I'm going to give you a very, very quick overview of this report. So next slide, please. And so I'm talking today about a new report that we released as part of the Children's Environmental Rights Initiative, which is a group of organizations working on child rights and the environment. This report is looking at climate finance in particular. And I think given the discussion today and the different challenges and solutions we've talked about, it's really important to then look about how we're going to actually finance this. So this is what the report does. It looks at different multilateral climate funds and assesses them on three criteria, which I'll go into in a second, and then provide some recommendations. The whole approach is trying to advance a climate justice approach. I saw in the Q&A some questions around the difference between industrialized and less industrialized countries and who's bearing the responsibility and ultimately the risk and impacts of the climate crisis. And this is what we hope the report will also help us to achieve in moving some of that finance from those causing the crisis to those who are facing the impact, and doing that in a way that is through grants, et cetera, to try and relieve kind of the debt piece as well. So this is a study that is the first of its kind. It looks at, as I've mentioned, 591 project proposals from multilateral climate funds from 2006 to 2023. Looking at a cumulative value of approximately $51 billion. We know that while multilateral climate funds have a relatively small share of the overall climate finance, they have a vital role to play in agenda setting and in catalyzing and coordinating investment by other public and private finance institutions at all different levels. Next slide, please. And so the methodology, we went through all of these different projects under multilateral climate funds and scored them against these three criteria. The first one, looking at whether children were meaningfully and explicitly included in the project design, activities and outcomes. The second one is looking at strengthening resilience for central services. And here we looked at education, health, food and nutrition, clean energy, social protection, WASH and DRR. And the third one was whether the projects are actually inclusive of children's participation, supporting their agency. So really linking with a lot of the discussion from today. Next slide, please. So the findings, we found that just 2.4% of funding, or 1.2 billion, can be classified as actually supporting child responsive activities. This constitutes 5% of the actual projects. So as you can see, there is a significant way to go in trying to ensure that climate finance is meeting the needs of children who we know are going to be facing the worst impacts of the climate crisis for the longest time and needing to find the solutions if we can't come up with them now. Next slide, please. We also looked at whether children or young people, so youth, were included more consistently. And while we didn't go into different age groups of children, we looked at under 18s, and we know that there are vast differences between those under five and those as 18-year-olds. We did try to differentiate between children and youth because we see that they're often bracketed together, yet their needs, vulnerabilities are vastly different. So where children and youth are mentioned, youth are much more commonly considered in multilateral climate funds. Next slide, please. We found that 35% of projects include some interventions to strengthen the resilience of essential social services. But when you dig into some of the findings, you see that there are vast differences again between different social sectors. So only one project focused explicitly on education. However, education interventions were incorporated in about 13% of the projects. So it is included, but not as like the sole objective of a project. Next slide, please. So on this slide, you can see the percentage of multilateral climate fund spending versus projects in the different sectors. And I will just pull out a few of these now. So you can see that health is the lowest, along with social protection. And sustainable energy, WASH, DRR, and education are a little bit higher up. But given the relatively low percentages across all of these, there is still a long way for us to go. Next slide, please. So when we're looking at health, some of the ways that we measured whether the health interventions were child responsive was looking at air pollution, fuel efficient cook stoves, et cetera, but looking at how they impact children explicitly. So you can see here that there are a relatively high amount on kind of food and nutrition, but very, very low amounts on health. So I think that gives us as a group a really good starting point to see how we can better include child responsiveness into any health interventions through multilateral climate funds, because we can see that is a significant gap. Next slide, please. The other significant gap I mentioned was around social protection. So we know that social protection is crucial, especially for supporting early childhood care and development, yet less than 1% of projects incorporated child-responsive social protection interventions. So again, a significant way for us to go on that. Next slide, please. And then energy, I think, is a really interesting one. Because this, as you would expect, has a higher proportion of projects, largely because a lot of projects focus more on mitigation than on adaptation and resilience. And a large proportion of energy interventions are focusing on health and ending air pollution, but not necessarily taking a child-responsive approach. So again, I think that while there are more funds available for this, the fact that not many are still looking at child-responsive health through energy gives us more entry points for us to continue this advocacy. Next slide, please. So just summing up, I know I've gone through the key findings quite quickly. You can find the report in the chat. But we have a couple of recommendations that I just wanted to highlight. So the first is really looking at how to scale up child and gender responsive climate finance. This is through strengthening the climate resilience of child critical social services along the lines of the ones I've just mentioned. And it's really vital that, as I mentioned before, the funding is coming through grants, through the loss and damage fund, et cetera. So not to add to the burden of debt, but really look at debt relief through this. The second is looking at how to bolster child responsive approaches in climate finance policies, strategies, plans, and guidance. So for example, can we institute a child marker to rate the contribution of each project? Can we look at adopting more guidance? Can we use the guidance highlighted today to really share with the multilateral climate fund so that they know what child responsive finance is and how it supports the youngest generation? And then increase child-responsive climate finance. So that's fairly obvious, but we need to look at how we also strengthen the capacity of different funds, how to have the evidence that they know to be able to take action, and how to also support children in engaging in these processes. So could we also have a child representative on some of the boards of multilateral climate funds, for example, to really make sure that we are targeting interventions towards children's rights? So I will stop there. Sorry for going so quickly. I hope you managed to get a bit of an overview, but I wanted to end on this. I know that there is a long way to go in terms of climate finance and the child responsiveness, but I want to end on a hope that through this, you can see that there are so many opportunities for us as a group to continue the climate advocacy, to make sure that we can push some of this climate finance to where it's needed most, to continue to protect the current and future generations and support intergenerational and climate justice. Thank you so much.
Thanks, Jessica. Thanks a lot for the very important report you spoke on the very fact that, you know, there's a lot of fund has been spent on talking about climate and also air pollution, but are we really targeting to have women and children as a focus, and how to have a systematic approach towards ensuring that, what evidence to collect, how do we really connect it with plans and strategies, policies, outcomes, are we really spending right, are we getting the real outcomes, and so on. It's very, very important topic. Thanks a lot for opening our mind on that. With that, we are coming to the end. We are quite 15 minutes more than time. And I will just quickly summarize. I think we had a great set of speakers today, spoke on this various aspects of this connecting children and climate and also the biggest problem of air pollution in the view of communication advocacy and connecting the ground understanding towards the government and policymakers, thinking about what are the knowledge products, what is the knowledge gap, how to bridge the gaps, and also the health understanding in the impact on children, frameworks of understanding vulnerability and, of course, financial frameworks. That's a great set of discussion. Now I will hand over to Evelyn to do the closing remarks.
Yeah, thank you, Sree. And it has been a very informative and engaging discussion. Thanks for the summary, Sree, of all the insights. But I just really want to thank all our speakers and our moderators for sharing their time, their expertise as it relates to the issue of air pollution and climate change, in general, as this affects young children and how, we should really further the link between early childhood development and climate change. Thank you to all our participants who stayed on. Sorry, we're really, over time, but it has been, our pleasure to host this webinar, and we hope that we continue to really be with us, in our journey in terms of addressing the intersection of ECD and climate change. I invite all of you to join us in our journey as we build a collective movement in support of young children's rights to a clean, healthy, secure, and sustainable environment. We have a lot of resources. If you can, scan, for you to have access to the different resources that we have generated over the past 2 years that we've been studying and understanding, the issue of climate change and young children. So once again, thank you all for joining. But before you leave, we request you to complete a short evaluation of today's webinar using the link in the chat box. Zhao, if you can flash the link, it will just take you about, a minute, but it will really help us to design future webinars and other learning events. So please, if you can help us with by providing feedback for today's webinar. Thank you and enjoy the rest of your day. Thank you, everyone. And Zhao, can we have a photo of all the speakers and moderators?
Sorry, you give me 1 minute. I think some of the panelists have already left.
Oh.
But for those maybe who are here, maybe we can just take a group photo for the speakers, moderator who are still here. Thank you.
If everyone's okay.
Thank you so much, everyone, for doing this together. If we can all have our videos turn on, and then, I can just take a screenshot.
Okay, thank you. All right, ready? 1, 2, 3, smile. Oh, smile. Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone. Thanks so much.
Bye. Thank you so much. Thank you.